Good morning, student. In today's video, I'm going to tell you about the remaining part of the lesson, The Happy Prince, written by Oscar Wilde. So, as I already told you that this story of Happy Prince is an allegory. That means, what is an allegory? It is a story which had some hidden meaning, and that can be based on political or moral one. That means that hidden meaning should have a moral theme or a political theme. And then till now we can see the sacrifice of Happy Prince, the sacrifice of Cello, the kindness of Happy Prince and the Cello, and whole day they are thinking about one thing only, that how they could help each other. And in fact, the prince has given so many things. When he saw the miseries of the people, he had given his expensive ruby from the hilt of the sword. Of course, he had given his eyes also, and he became blind forever. And the third thing he had is the layer of gold, which he is thinking to give to other people so that they can lead a peaceful and good life. So here we see the scenario is completely based on sacrifice and love and kindness. Now, as I told you, I will tell just a refresh then before explaining the chapter. So as I told you that the statue of the Happy Prince was very big, and it was standing on the tall top column in the city, and he was covered all over with the pure gold leaves. He had two bright sapphire and for his eyes, and large ruby glowed on the sword hilt. Now children, sapphire and ruby, they are the stones, they are the precious stones. Sapphire is of blue color and ruby is of red color. So this is of the, these are the precious stone of which the prince was decorated. So one day what happened, a little swallow came and sat on the statue. He decided to spend the night on it, but as he was going to sleep, a large drop of water fell on him. The swallow was amazed. He was shocked because there was no cloud and yet it was raining. Then the second drop of water made the swallow decide to fly up. Now children, the second drop of water came and the swallow thought that it's better to fly off. Now when the third drop of water fell on her, he started looking at the statue, and finally she realized that the tears are rolling down from the eyes of the Happy Prince. Now the statue speaks to her, and he speaks that when he was alive, so he was very happy, and now when he is dead, he is standing on the pillar from where he could see all the miseries and suffering of the people, and that's why he was crying. And now he is requesting the bird Cello to stay with him, but the bird straight away refused. He told, I have to go to Egypt because all my friends are waiting. But the Happy Prince told him to be his messenger only for one day. Now what happened? The Happy Prince told the Cello that there was a woman far away. She was a seamstress. She was embroidering the flower on the satin gown of the Queen's maid of honor. His son, he is suffering from fever. In fact, he is very hungry, but she don't have any food to give it to her, and she did not have money to buy the medicine. So he requests to give the hilt of the sword, which is made of ruby. Finally, the Cello, he told okay, because he is also having a kind nature. He is also of generous nature, so he agreed to give that ruby hilt to the lady who was embroidering the satin gown for the house of maid to wear in the court party, in the ball party. Well, and then again he came back to the happy prince and he told that today I am going to Egypt. But then again happy prince requested him to stay for one more night. This time happy prince told him to help a playwright, as he was feeling cold and his financial conditions were not good to buy the stuff. So the happy prince told the bird that you just take one of the sapphire from my eyes and just keep it on the table. At first the bird doesn't want to do that, because she thinks that if she will take away the sapphire, then the prince will become blind. But the prince, he insisted her to do that thing. Finally the swallow took out the sapphire from the eyes of the prince and kept on the table of the playwright. So this is the second time he is helping him. Now third time, children, a girl was going and she was selling matchstick boxes was there with her hand. She used to sell matchstick. Now she knew if she will not take the money to her father, she would be beat in a very cruel manner. And unfortunately that day the whole box of match fell into the gutter. The prince was feeling very pity for her, and he told Salo that go and give some thing to her, the other sapphire to her, so that she could buy something and she will not get the beating. So when the Salo heard this, she told, no, I cannot do that because you will become completely blind. But the prince insisted him to do that thing also. He told, no, you have to take the eyes for my sake, you have to take it, because that girl will be beaten by her father, and this he won't be able to tolerate it, the happy prince. The Salo did according to the prince. She had taken the other eyes of the prince, and now she had put in the palms of that girl. The girl is very happy. Well, but when she came back to the prince, she had seen the prince has become completely blind. Now he's not able to see, but he can feel the misery of the people. Now the prince tells the Salo that you can go to Egypt now, but the Salo refuses by telling that now she don't want to go to Egypt as he was completely blind. He needs someone beside him. I'm going to read the text from the beginning, page number 32, and I will do the explanation part. Now he ordered the Salo to pluck out one of them and take one of them, what? One of the sapphire of the eyes, from the eyes. Then take it to the playwright. He will sell it to the jeweler and buy firewood and finish his play. Now he's telling that it's better you go and put that sapphire into the decks of the playwright, and then he won't suffer. He won't feel cold and he would be able to write his own story. Dear prince, said the Salo, I cannot do that. And he began to weep because he did not want to make the prince blind by taking away his eyes. Salo, Salo, little Salo, the prince said, do as I command you. Now the prince forced him and told that since he is the king, he is the prince, and do as he is commanding. Now the Salo could not refuse. She plucked the prince's eyes and flew away to the young man's garret. It was easy enough to get in, as there was a hole in the roof. Now very easily she went to the room of the playwright, because there was a hole in the roof, and in this way she had helped him. The young man had its head buried in his hand. Now his head was buried in his hand, so he did not hear the flutter of the bird's wing, and when he looked up he found the beautiful sapphire lying on the withered violet. Withered means dry. And he thought that his people are beginning to appreciate him, and he felt happy. He never thought in a dream that it was the happy prince, that he had given his own eye to help him so that he could write, he could finish his story. This is from some great admirer, he thought. The next day the sallow flew down to the harbor. He sat on the mast of a large vessel. Mast is a pole, the upper portion of the pole of the ship, and watched the sailors working. I'm going to Egypt now. This time he decided that this time I will go to Egypt surely. But nobody minded, and when the moon rose he flew back to the happy prince. And now children, when the moon rose he wanted to meet to the happy prince before going, but he when he came back to bid goodbye, the prince told Sallow, Sallow, little Sallow, said the prince, will you not stay with me one night longer? It's winter, said the Sallow, and the snow will soon be here, and then I will die. In Egypt the sun is warm on the green palm leaf. That means it is hot summer season there, and in the summer season they will not have fear to die. I'm going to Egypt, cried the Sallow, but nobody minded, and when the moon rose he flew back to the happy prince, and happy prince told him once again not to go. She wanted to go because she knew that her life would be in danger during the winter. So, but then when the prince requested again and again, she was ready to help him. In the square below, said the prince, there stands a little match girl. Now he is telling about a little match girl. She has let her matches fall in the gutter. That means her all matches have fallen in the gutter, and they're all spoiled. The father will beat her if she does not bring home some money. He's telling the thing is that his father will beat her very much when she will not get the money. And she is crying, and that's why she is crying. She has no more of a stocking, and her little head is bare. Pluck out my other eyes and give it to her, and her father will not beat her. Now that girl, she was so poor that she was neither having the stockings nor she had shoes, and it was quite cold. Now he is telling that you have to pluck my other eyes and give it to the girl. Well, finally he did accordingly to the prince, the little Sallow. In this way the girl father did not beat her, and children, finally a new decision was taken by the Sallow. I will stay with you one night longer, said the Sallow, but I cannot pluck out your eyes. You would be quite blind then. The Sallow told that this will be too much for the prince. He could not bear him seeing that he will become blind, and then it would be a problem for him. So he advises the princess not to do, but the prince did not listen. Instead, he told that you have to pull out his eyes to help the girl. Now, the Sallow, he was having a very good nature. He came back to the prince and he told that now he had thought to live with him forever, because as the prince has become blind. So this, see how nice both the prince and Sallow were. Well, the prince told, no, now you can go to your home. Now you can go back to Egypt. But it was Sallow who did not agree. Now she really wanted to stay with the prince. Now I will stay with you always, said the Sallow, and he slept at the prince's feet. All the next day he sat on the prince shoulder and told him stories of what he had seen in Springland. Now children, whole day the cello it sang, it told some of the tale from those country where he had been earlier, and he told the prince that it is all wonderful thing which I will tell you. And he sat on the prince's shoulder and started telling the story. Now, dear little cello, the prince told her, dear little cello, you tell me of marvelous thing, but more marvelous than anything is the suffering of the men and women. There is no mystery as great as misery. Fly over me, my city, little cello, and tell me what you see there. Now, children, the prince told the cello that you are telling me the tale of a wonderful cities and the wonderful places, but for me, according to this, for me, he is telling, for me, suffering of the men and women, they are the mysteries as great as misery, misery, and he will tell him whatever he had seen, what the prince wanted to have to report whatever he had seen. And this time he requested also, fly over to my city, little cello, and tell me what you see there. Now, in fact, the prince had requested cello to stay with him and take a round all over the city, and now he can tell about the suffering of the people, that how they are what type of suffering they were having, what type of sorrow they were having, and how he can help those persons. So the prince wanted to from his cello that he should tell the misery of the people, and he should fly all over the city. Now the cello, it had done accordingly what the prince wanted. He had done according to that only. Well, now cello flew over the city and he saw the rich making merry in their beautiful houses. When he took the round, he saw that there were many rich people who were enjoying in their houses. They are not feeling cold. They are very much comfortable in their houses. Now I am reading here, and children, where he went, I am reading this paragraph. So the cello flew over the great city and saw the rich making merry to the beautiful in the beautiful houses, while the beggars were sitting at the gates, and the beggars were sitting at the gate of the rich people, but their least bothered, they are not giving anything to them. He flew into the dark lanes and saw the white faces of the starving children looking out listlessly at the black street under the archway of a bridge. Now children, he also saw that the few beggars, they were sitting near the gate and they were not having money, not having food, and they were feeling hungry. Now he flew into dark lane. Now again the cello flew into dark lane and saw the white faces of starving children. Suddenly he saw that two children are there and they are starving. Starving means they are so hungry that they may die. So these children, what they are doing? They are simply starving. Now the cello feels very sad. He looking out listlessly at the black street under the archway of a bridge, two little boys were lying in each other's arms to try and keep themselves warm. Now he further moved, and this time what he found that the two boys, they were very they were very small boys, and they were putting their arms on towards each other, and in this way they have symptoms from the cold. How hungry we are. At the same time, Silo heard them saying that they are so hungry. "You must not lie there," shouted the watchman, and they wandered out into the rain. Now children, it was raining as well as it was winter, so you can imagine how much cold the child must have been feeling. So they said, "You must not lie there," shouted the watchman. Suddenly the watchman also came there. He told that this is not the place to lie, and they wandered out in the rain. Wander means they moved in the rainfall. They have become very vagabond. They don't know from where they would go. Then he flew back and told the prince what he had seen. Now children, he told everything to the prince, that what he had seen. He was told, he gave all, each and every report he gave to the prince. Now the prince was very sad, and he told him to, this time you should take away all the gold for which his body was covered. So the prince is telling to take away all the gold. He did not want the gold. Instead, he wanted the Selu to help the children who were starving, and the other two children who went out in the rain, and they were having anything to put on their body, and it was very cold. Then let's see what the Selu did. "I'm covered with fine gold," said the prince. "You must take it off leaf by leaf." That means he told him, after layer and layer, one by one layer, you take it and give it to the poor. The living always think fine gold can make them happy. Now children, it is a belief among the people that if they will have gold, they can sell that gold anytime, and this way they will be happy. Leaf after leaf of the fine gold the Selu picked off, till the happy prince looked quite dull and gray. Now the Selu started taking out all the golden leaf from the prince's body, and now the whole statue looked dull and gray. And the children's faces grew rosier, and they laughed and played in the street. "We have bread now." They were so happy now that they had something to eat. Then the snow came, and after the snow came the frost. The street looked as if they were made of silver. Well, there was the winter season was there, of course, I was telling. And after the summer season, what happened? The winter came, and with that winter came the snowfall and frost. Frost is a small pieces of snow which is falling, which falls from the sky. So now after a snowfall there came frost, or the flicker snow which fall slowly. Now the fear had come, that Selu, he was going to the Egypt because he was fearing the moment he will face snowfall he would die. And children, same thing has happened. Everybody went about in fur. Everybody was putting a fur coat, which were very expensive, little boy skated on the ice. Now children, the two boys who were very hungry, now with the when they got the golden leaf, they first thing they purchased warm clothes for themselves, and they put a special type of cap from saving themselves to the winter, from saving themselves from winter season. And these children, they were skating, they enjoy their life, and this happened due to the sacrifice of Sallu and Happy Prince. So a crumbs outside the bakery door when the baker was not looking, and he tried to keep himself warm by flapping his rim. Now children, he went to the baker's, he had some crumbs, and he went to the baker's to the bakery purposely so that he could feel some warm. But at last he knew that he was going to die. Now finally children, he could not bear his body, could not bear cold, and he knew that he is going to die. He had just enough strength to fly up to the prince's shoulder once more. Goodbye dear prince, he murmured. Now children, before he knew, now his end has come, and before that he wanted to die. Before dying he wanted to see Happy Prince. So he went to meet the prince. Now the prince told, I am glad that you are going to Egypt, last little Sallu, said the prince. Now the prince had seen that there was a snowfall. He thought that this is time for the Sallu to leave for Egypt. So he told, I know that you, I am glad that today you are going to Egypt finally, and you have stayed too long here, but you must kiss me on the lips, for I love you. Now the prince told that I really love you, and before bidding me goodbye you must kiss me on my lips, because even the prince started liking, and he was so much obliged to him, and he started loving him. It is not to Egypt that I am going, said the Sallu. I am going to the house of death. Now the Sallu told that he is going to the house of death. Well, the prince was surprised, and told, as the Sallu told him, I am going to the house of death. Death is the brother of sleep, is he not? Now he is telling that means death and sleep are alike, they are like brothers, so no matter. And he kissed the Happy Prince on the lips and fell down dead at his feet. Still, in the moment he had kissed the lips of Happy Prince, at that same time he fell on the feet of the Happy Prince, and now that Sallu, he is dead, he is no more. At that moment a curious crack sounded inside the statue. Children, when the prince saw Now, early the next morning, the mayor was walking in the square below in company with the town councillor. Now children, early that morning, the mayor was taking round to the city. As they passed the column, he looked up at the statue. Suddenly children, the mayor and was walking, who was seeing everything. And he was having few companies also, like the town councillor was with him. As they passed the column, he looked up at the statue and said, dear me, how shabby the Happy Prince looks, he said. Now he told, it's looking very sad, shabby, the statue is not looking good, because all the golden layer and the blue sapphire and everything was not there it the statue has turned into a dull and gray color metal. So these even they are shocked, the town councillor and the mayor. Now they started discussing among themselves. The ruby has fallen out of his sword, his eyes are gone. They told that the ruby had fallen from his eyes, from the sword hilt, and the sapphire were again taken by along with the golden leaf. So he told the mayor that now nothing is there in the prince. In fact, he is little better than a beggar. He told that he is little better than a beggar. And here is actually a dead bird at his feet, continued the mayor. We must really issue a proclamation. We must really issue a proclamation. Dead birds are not to be allowed to die here. And he told children, what a stupid talk they are doing. Okay, death, it can come to anybody at any time. But here what they are saying, that we will not allow we will not allow any bird to die here. So instead of feeling shame, they are telling this only. And proclamation is meaning is announcement of the order. What is the meaning of proclamation? Proclamation means announcing of the order. What was the order? That from now on, nobody bird will die where the statues are kept. So you can see there is a story, there is a satire in the story. This is the figure of speech which is used here. The town clerk made a note and suggestion what his boss has said, and now they pulled down the statue of the happy prince. As he no longer is beautiful, he is no longer useful, said the art professor at the university. Now the art professor, even he was feeling sad when he saw the condition of happy prince. For the sake of others, he even died. So they pulled down the statue of the happy prince. As he is no longer beautiful, he is no longer useful, said the art professor at the university. Then they melted the statue in a furnace. Now the story was, the statue was thrown in the furnace. What a strange thing, said the overseer of the workmen at the foundry. This broken lead heart will not melt in the furnace. Now children, in spite of giving a lot of heat, the whole statue melted, but the heart was not melting. We must throw away it. So they threw it on a dust heap where the dead Solo was lying. Now children, that heart was thrown to the very same place. Isn't it strange that where the dead Solo was lying, and that part where the dead Solo was lying buried, it had turned into a dust heap. So now the heart of the prince and the body of the bird, they were in the same place. Now children, here one day the God has asked the angel, bring me the two most precious thing in the city, said God to one of his angels. And the angels brought him leader the leaden heart and the dead burden of the God. Ask angel, now I want two best things. Two best things I want. Now they have searched everywhere and finally they have bought the leaden heart of the prince and the dead bird. You have rightly chosen, said God, for in my garden of paradise this little bird shall sing forever, and in my city of gold the happy prince shall praise me. Now this was answer given by the angels to God. He told that for in my garden of paradise this little bird shall sing and staying for even more, and now children, what is, first of all let me explain you what is a garden of paradise. Now garden of paradise, it is believed that there is a beautiful garden in the heaven, and that garden is known as garden of paradise, where the flower, the tree, it remain as fresh as it ever, it never dry, it never die. So God has taken, God has called them and told the angels that the laden heart, that means the happy prince and the swallow, should be there in my garden of paradise, and the bird will sing forever, and the prince in my city of gold, he will praise me. So children, with this I have come to the end of the lesson. In fact, your lesson is finished now. Now one thing which I wanted to know, that what is the theme of the story? The theme of the story is that we should be show love, kindness, and we should be sacrificing, we should not do any evil deed. So this is having a lot of theme there is in this lesson. So you can see, you can read when I tell you through my video. I also wanted you to do the reading so that you will become more perfect in your studies. Now with this I end my video here. Thank you and have a nice day.